Good afternoon, wherever you're joining from. Thanks for that introduction. So today we'll be talking about how to what's the benefit of integrating the next generation firewall with your MDR or XDR solution. All right. So you might have heard a lot about Sophos MDR over the past couple of months, but MDR is nothing if you don't get the visibility that is required. So MDR is more like a SOC, a security operation center. That's what exactly what it is. So in a normal security operation center, you would have stuff like firewalls, switches, routers, endpoint, EDR, all of them sending their telemetry into a SIEM solution. So the SIEM is like the dashboard or the scoreboard to show what's happening at all the various security layers. But all of that is not useful if you don't correlate them, if you don't make use of that visibility to help you pinpoint the source of an attack and narrow it down quickly to terminate it. So we're going to be talking about the importance of integrating your firewall with a Sophos MDR solution. I'll be talking about third-party firewalls now, not Sophos firewalls. So if you're using any third-party firewall, then this is definitely for you. So currently, today's environment is dispersed. People work from anywhere. Data has moved to the public cloud, or people can access data from anywhere, and data can reside anywhere as well. So it makes it quite challenging for cybersecurity teams to have visibility into such data. Now, the challenge there also is that beyond having visibility, you need to be able to control what users do. You need to be able to also respond to attacks if found. And the only way to do that is to have that visibility across those multiple layers. So that means most organizations have deployed several tools at various areas. One of them includes a firewall. So you have firewall on-premise, firewall in the cloud, firewall in the private cloud, firewall in the DR, firewall everywhere. And telemetry from firewall is really, really critical if you look at it. So these are some of the common integrations that we see in a normal security operations center. The endpoint is to help to detect suspicious activity and malware activity and report them to your tool, whatever tool it is you're using. The firewall basically helps to see any intrusion attacks and also attempt to communicate with the command and control center. That's if you're already compromised. So the firewall is able to see that. So there are modules like the IPS, the ATP that helps to mostly do that. Then we have identity integration as well. So if you have Entra ID, Okta, Duo, this helps to manage who has access to what within your network. So identity integration can also help a SOC to detect any unauthorized network activity and also misuse of privilege or permissions. Email integration is also there. Email helps to identify initial entry by malware actors and any attempt to try to steal data through malicious means. Yes, also cloud integration. So if you have AWS, Azure, GCP, there are ways you can also import the telemetry from those cloud environments, the security events, and bring them to your SOC so that your SOC analyst or your SIEM engineers can make use of that telemetry and help to identify and prevent those attacks or stop those attacks as much as possible. So any stuff like unauthorized network access or malicious API calls or malicious logins from multiple locations or even data exfiltration can be exported into the SOC, the Security Operations Center. And then there's also the network integration. How does this differ from the firewall integration? Network integration has more to do with what's happening on the LAN or on the network itself. Firewall is an edge device. Firewall is able to inspect traffic going in and out of the network, right? While the network solution itself, which could be an NDR, that's network detection and response, or an NB or NT as it were, traffic analysis or behavioral detection. Now, this network-based solutions will identify lateral movement, for example, what's happening from east to west traffic, So to a compromised asset within the network trying to infect another asset within the network will not be detected by a firewall typically. So that will depend on a network detection and response solution that's able to collect traffic from the switches and the access points and the servers and bring them together at the network layer, which doesn't get to the gateway. If it's going out of the gateway, then the firewall will see. So that's where the network layer is very important. So network protection would help to identify unprotected assets or rogue assets, and also attacks that have never been seen before. So all of these tools, they play a very key role, and they are quite useful, but they're only as useful as you can use them, as you can see them. So if you have individual detection from all these various solutions, and you don't bring those detections together to be able to make sense of it all, then it will limit you greatly in your ability to be able to correlate on time and respond on time. And when we're talking about cybersecurity attacks, time is of the essence. So in summary, a firewall will be able to help you to monitor in and out traffic, like I said, north-south traffic, or traffic traversing the gateway, going to the internet or coming to your network. The firewall is built to be able to have visibility into that traffic and can help you to mine the security events from that and share it with your SOC or your SIEM tool, as it were, to help your engineers, have better visibility to investigate further. Now, if you don't combine the visibility from the multiple integration sources that you have, then you will struggle to respond. For example, if you have an endpoint and a firewall, an endpoint could show you that there's an unknown process execution on a particular IP address. The firewall could also show you that there's DLP prevention on that IP address, and also a particular process is using a non-standard port as well. These are two alerts that don't really make sense. But when you have a way to combine the two telemetry, you will now realize that there's data exfiltration attempts ongoing or trying to occur on that particular IP address, because you can then pull the telemetry together and correlate them. Similarly, if you look at the network detection and response and the endpoint standing alone, the NDR is detecting communication on the internal network from a particular IP address. Of course, that's what it does. But then the endpoint also says that this a particular IP address that's communicating is not under management. That means it doesn't have the endpoint agent on it. If you put these two together, that means you look at all the endpoints that are managed compared to all the IP addresses or MAC addresses that are competing on the NDR, you find out that there are some devices there that are not managed or could be rogue devices. So by putting the two together, you get better visibility. And I can go on and on with this. So basically, what I'm trying to say is, if you're getting telemetry from various sources, multiple sources, if those sources are not combined, if they're not correlated, there is no point, because it would take you very long to make sense of it, and you would miss very, very important signals. So to identify important signals that could help you to detect an attack early, you have to be able to combine those signals together by integrating them. So let me give you an example now. You can see three firewall vendors. They're reporting exactly the same alert, the same detection, right? But it's different the way it's been structured. So I've highlighted the severity score. So vendor A is seeing the severity score for the same detection is a score of 4. Vendor B is saying it's 7. Vendor C is saying it's 9. So for a SOC engineer, for those that are SOC engineers here, I believe you'll be able to relate to what I'm talking about. So it makes it very difficult for you. So where do you start from? So this is non-standardized, and it makes it very difficult to process, for you to prioritize, for example, because when you work in a SOC, you have to be able to prioritize this detection. Otherwise, you'll be working all day and you won't achieve that much. And those are three different firewalls. Now imagine, because everyone has various other solutions that they use. So not just firewalls. We're talking about the firewall, email, identity, cloud, NDR, and the rest, and the endpoint as well. So if you're now to correlate a detection across multiple sources, on time to identify a signal. So imagine having to look at the firewall, the email, the identity. So you can already tell that it's going to be very, very difficult for you to make sense of it. And that is exactly the issue with having a SIEM solution and then getting all the alerts. Then what do you do with it? How do you make sense of it, right? That's a major issue. So it's very difficult to get that telemetry together, because number one, the scoring is inconsistent. So some OEMs would have scoring metric of 1 to 10. Some would say it's 5 to 1. Same detection, but different scoring. Some would have high, medium, low, instead of the 1 to 10, 5 to 1. So it's very difficult to correlate data effectively and accurately if the scoring is inconsistent. That's a major issue. Secondly, because of the various type of information and the proprietary method that each OEM uses to generate those alerts, it's very difficult to identify the issues in a timely manner. You could see if I scroll back a bit, same detection, you can see the information is different, the flow is different, right? So it becomes very difficult for you to make sense of it all. Also, the reporting is highly varied, and that creates a lot of alert fatigue for IT team because they have to manually drill down and bake that information, if I could put it that way, to be able to get the useful data from it. So that makes it very difficult to pull telemetry together, especially when you have one or two different solutions in the organization. That's what most organizations have. You have different solutions for different areas of the network. So at Sophos, what we do is we gather all the data sources, gather all the telemetry, and put them into our data lake that helps us to structure the data for the detection pipeline. Detection pipeline helps us to clean, to filter, and to enrich the data we've got into data lake, and then create a case if required, and then escalate it to the MDR operations. So that means the detection pipeline is very, very key to us at Sophos. So what we do with that detection pipeline is to focus on filtering what is required, because not every alert is required, right? So there are some that have to do with general stuff, but there are some that have to do with security events, which are critical to us. So we'll filter out the noise and ingest all of them and filter out the noise, and then clean it to ensure that we can standardize it, and enrich it, correlate it, and also prioritize, and if required, escalate it. So I'm just going to list out the key points of the detection pipeline, because that's a very, very critical point for us to be able to integrate multiple sources into our MDR SOC. So the first is to ingest telemetry from those multiple sources and remove unwanted noise. Like I said, we don't need everything. We need only the security events critical to our detection. We'll transform the data into normalized schema, the schema that helps the data lake, that helps us to get a schema that can give us the required data tables that we can then map to the MITT and CK framework. Once cleaned, we'll then enrich it with third-party intelligence. Third-party threat intelligence helps us to add context to what we've detected. So if there are things that have been detected by some other OEMs or some other threat intelligence, we can bring all of that together, for example, Cisco Talos. From there, we can then correlate those alerts based on entities, MITRE ITC and CK categorization, and the time scale, the timestamps as well. So most of the time, a detection flag would show some things happening at exactly the same time, across email, firewall, endpoint, or network detection and response. So that time is going to be very key for us to be able to get the required context to be able to flag or prioritize a particular attack. Prioritization, we'll be able to score those alerts and cluster them. We'll cluster them, the alerts that there's sometimes there are several detections, for a particular, for a single event, right? So there could be several detections, or there could be some repeat detections. We can cluster them so that we can reduce the noise. So instead of having 100 detection, we can say there's one detection happening 100 times, so that we reduce the noise as much as possible. And then we can then prioritize them so that the responders or the SOC engineers or analysts can start from the most important ones and skip the noise, so they can identify the important signals and skip the noise. So the prioritization could be critical, could be high, could be medium, could be low. And then we can escalate if it requires. So if there's a particular case that needs to, a particular detection that needs to be escalated into a case so that we can investigate, we will then create that as well and extend it to create a case and send it to the MDR operations to investigate. The MDR operations are cybersecurity experts, are SOC experts who work on threat hunting, threat detection, and remediation. Then they will start working on it. So that's basically how the security event flow works for our Sophos MDR. So you can see why this is very important for us to get it right the first time. So I'm going to take one report that we pulled in one single day. In one single day, when we had at the time when we had about 13,000 customers, now we have about 22,000 MDR, Sophos MDR customers, and we had 13,000 customers sometime last year. We pulled a report. We found out that there were about 31 billion events. That's in one single day. From that 31 billion events, we passed them through the security event flow that I showed you earlier, we're able to get 358 million detections from them. So imagine you had a SOC and your SOC was showing you 80,000 events. Out of the 80,000 events, there are probably only about maybe 8,000 detections, from them. But in any case, this one we had about 358,000 detections. And from these 358,000 detections, we generated only 367 cases which needed to be investigated. From 367 cases, there were 47 escalations to the MDR team. 47 escalations resulted in only one active threat. So out of all of this, there was only one active threat. So imagine in a SOC, you are getting hundreds of thousands of alerts on a daily basis. And out of those hundreds of thousands of alerts, there's only one key signal there that you needed to investigate. But because of the noise, you would miss that signal investigating, other stuff because you didn't have the way to be able to pass them through a funnel that basically reduces the noise from you so you can separate the needle from the haystack. And that's what we do for you. So with us, we're able to detect and respond in less than 1 hour. For most internal SOC teams, they can do it in 16 hours, which is almost like 2 business days. And we're talking about time being a very critical factor. So we can identify, we can detect, we can investigate and remediate in just about 38 minutes. That gives you peace of mind. So currently, we can integrate with multiple OEM, multiple vendors. When it comes to firewall, for example, you can see the common ones there. The big boys are also represented. So if you're using any of the third-party firewalls, we're not saying you should replace them. We're saying let's get the telemetry from that firewall into the SOC, into the MDR, to be able to identify important signals so that we don't miss those signals and can pinpoint the source of attack on time and remediate it on time. That's the key thing. So there are several other OEM that we support. You can see some of them on this slide as well. Microsoft integration, Google integration is free, with our Sophos MDR as well. So there are other add-on integrations too. You can see the firewalls, the most common firewalls that we use in this country or in this region are also well represented. So I'm going to show you some real-world use cases for this. So take, for example, there's a customer that has a Sophos endpoint but has a third-party firewall, right? So on this in this Sophos environment in this customer's environment, the customer did not have the Sophos XDR agent on the server itself that is hosting a particular application. So on the firewall side, the active adversary tried to conduct a ping sweep, that is trying to look for open ports, on the customer's environment, the DMZ side. So it runs this using a particular IP address, found the server, and then tries to inject commands to the application, trying to exploit the vulnerability. The firewall did not block the connection outright, but the firewall was able to detect the exploit and created an alert for it. So that alert was able to was seen by the SOC, the MDR team. Also, the endpoint accessing the firewall was also able to generate two different alerts. So we have three different alerts consolidated into one cluster because it's a single case, right? So there's no point having multiple cases for one single detection. So we consolidated the three into one. We're able to investigate. We found out that the IP address was trying to sweep conduct ping sweep on port 9034. That's the port that it was trying to use. The IP address was confirmed to be malicious. And then we confirmed that there was no internal network that had been seen related to that same IP address. So there was no lateral movement yet. As of now, there was no major compromise yet. So Sophos MDR team, of course, because it's a third party firewall, we don't have access to it. We don't have any control over it. We're able to advise the customer on the next steps. We told the customer to block the IP address at the firewall level and said to install the Sophos XDR agent on the server itself, hosting that particular application. So that would help us to proactively remove any remnants of whatever the attacker might have dropped there. And also to upgrade that application to the latest version because the current one was obviously vulnerable. Okay, another one, a customer that I was using Sophos endpoint but third-party firewall, and they were getting we were seeing lots of alerts, hundreds of alerts, coming into the the SOC from this third-party firewall. So in this particular case, the attacker tried to brute force SSH with several login attempts from different IP addresses. Of course, the SSH is mostly used for bringing users from the internet or from anywhere into the secure shell of that particular operating system, so that you can query it, you can run commands, you can remotely log in, and you can execute your command line as such. So this is what SSH is mostly used for. But in this case now, the customer's firewall was able to block that malicious connection from that client, and then generated lots of alerts, hundreds of them in a short period of time, attempted logins, failed logins from that particular firewall. So our SOC was able to correlate all of this together, able to consolidate the alerts together, and able to see that the SSH was exposed on the client computer, publicly exposed to the, that's when you expose SSH to the internet. That's exactly what the customer had done. Although the attacker was trying several attempts to log in, there was no successful login. Investigating further, we found the source IP, and the IP address was abusive to SSH and brute force attempts, but it was not classified by any security vendor yet as malicious, so it wasn't really known. So what we advised the customer to do was to disable SSH on the device so that it's no longer exposed to the public, so that way the attacker could not exploit SSH on that device. But at that time, there was no need to block the IP address, as the firewall was already blocking the malicious connections. So one last example was a major customer. This person became our customer. They weren't the support customer, but they became a customer eventually. They are fintech customer. They have to meet ISO compliance, PCI, and the rest. Their cybersecurity team is quite advanced, even though they are kind of short-staffed. They have about a few thousand users, but only 5 people are in the cybersecurity team. It's like overworking that team, really, if you look at it. So this team of 5 people are responsible for training the staff on cybersecurity awareness, phishing simulation, social engineering, and the rest. And also they have a SOC, a security operations center, that is running 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. And they claim to have an incident response plan. So they're kind of advanced when it comes to cybersecurity compared to the average, Nigerian customer. They're kind of advanced. They have all kind of tools deployed. They have SIEM solutions, they have firewall, they have network admission control, they have antivirus, email security, patch management, privilege access management, endpoint detection and response, cloud firewall. They have all of those solutions, and they have integrated them with the SIEM, to some extent. I showed you earlier, integrating with the SIEM is one half of the problem. The other problem is that you're going to get a lot of alerts that you don't even know what to do with it. That's the major problem, because you have to properly be able to filter and correlate them. Now, they have a security operations center with 2 junior threat analysts out of the 5 people that they have. 2 of them are junior threat analysts that work at the SOC, but they can only work Monday to Friday during work hours. And they use some level of artificial intelligence to assist them with threat response. But eventually, there was an attack on the weekend, because they only work, they close on Friday night. So they gave an attacker VPN access. Sorry, they gave a contractor VPN access into their cloud server. That's the cloud server hosting the web service on Azure. They gave them the VPN access. Unfortunately for them, the contractor was now compromised by an active address. So the attacker took over that computer, and by extension was able to connect through RDP to that server in the cloud, and was able to compromise that server. Because there was a VPN connection from the cloud to the on-premise, so that there's a site-to-site connection, so they could communicate privately, the attacker was able to also extend its reach to the on-premise domain controller on that same Friday night and compromise that domain controller, and then spend the entire weekend moving laterally, exfiltrating confidential document to the cloud and stuff. And by Monday morning or by Sunday night, the attacker was able to deploy a ransomware attack. So they came in on Monday morning, and everything was down, and the attacker was demanding $10 million. So there are several challenges here that you can see. First, with the access, normally you should not give contractors VPN access to your network. Actually, you should not give anyone that is not in the IT team VPN access. The recommendation is to use Zero Trust Network Access. That's the ZTNA. Of course, the customer was very smart here, so to speak. They gave the only enabled internal RDP, no external RDP, but the attacker was able to bypass that by using the VPN and then internal RDP. So some customers would use stuff like AnyDesk, or TeamViewer, which attackers could also still leverage if they can take over the system itself. In this case, that was what happened. So you have to ensure that anyone connecting to your network to manage your network is not compromised. And that includes third-party contractors. You have to ensure that they have the right antivirus and the devices are clean before they can connect to your network. So that's very, very important as well. So in this case, the customer's current SOC was costing them about $1 million a year. That's the annual recurrent bills of the SOC itself, including the staffing and the EDR and all the various tools that they had, the SIEM solution, all subscription-based, costing so much money. The attacker was demanding about $10 million in ransom to be paid. So in any case, Sophos MDR Complete offers a breach protection warranty of up to $1 million in response expenses, which can be claimed if there's a major breach and you lose your files, you can't get your files back, a major ransomware attack, then you're entitled to up to $1,000 per device and up to $1 million in total. I'm just going to talk briefly about the active threat response. This is a feature we have within Sophos itself. We're using the Sophos ecosystem, that's the adaptive cybersecurity ecosystem, that includes the Sophos firewall, Sophos MDR, and Sophos endpoint, right? So this would help us to be able to identify attacks in real time and stop them in real time, actively. So what does this mean? If for example, we find a malicious IP address that is trying to attack your users, we detect it on the, let's say on the MDR dashboard or the XDR dashboard. You can actively create a threat feed, a dynamic threat feed that could, using APIs already integrated to the Sophos Central, the firewall will then get this update immediately, even though the IP address has not been detected by other third-party providers or security or threat intelligence has not detected it as a malicious IP address. We can proactively, from the Sophos Central, create a dynamic threat feed to the firewall. The firewall then blocks that IP address automatically so that the attacker can no longer communicate through that IP address. And also, it will inform all the endpoints within the network, all the managed endpoints, that a particular IP address is connected, is trying to compromise them, and they should not accept any connection from it. Also, if there's any already compromised device within the network, the endpoint could also inform all the other endpoints to block that particular endpoint within the network. That's this is lateral movement protection now, to block that particular device from communicating with them, so that the attacker would not be able to have access to them. And all of these does not require any firewall reconfiguration. So imagine you were at home when this happened. Attention, you have to now log into the firewall and then create a rule or use a particular means to block a particular IP address. But with the active threat response, you don't have to do that. The threat feed is created dynamically and sent via API to your Sophos firewall to automatically block it. Now, if you're using a third-party firewall, it would have been possible because we would have had to, reach out to you and tell you to block a particular IP address immediately, which you may or may not be available to do. Like in the case of the example I gave you, where the guys only work from 9 to 5, after work hours, nobody will be able to log into the firewall to block that IP address. On weekends, nobody will be able to log into that firewall to block that IP address. But if it was a Sophos firewall, the MDR team will be able to push the threat feed to that firewall to block that IP address, right? So what this basically means is you need to ensure that if you're using, third-party tools, non-Sophos tools, try to ensure that your SOC, if you have a SOC, try to ensure that your SOC is running 24/7, or that you have someone present to be able to assist remediation activities, 24/7. The ones that are beyond the reach of Sophos, for example. So that's very, very key. So other OEMs also trust us. There are several OEMs using our solutions for threat intelligence, for the network antivirus, for anti-spam, for sandboxing, and various other purposes. Some of them you might already know from this screenshot. So in summary, we recommend that you deploy zero trust, across all your externally facing assets. So if you have any externally facing assets that people have to access, like SharePoint or file servers or web portal, make sure you're securing it with ZTNA and not VPN. VPN is not the right way to secure externally facing assets. Neither is RDP nor Anydesk a way to secure connection from your contractors. Also, make sure that you are patching your applications and operating systems regularly. It's important to educate your staff on phishing, business email compromise, attacks, social engineering, and the rest. Most importantly, ensure that your defense is a 24/7 operation, right? So defense cannot be a 9-to-5 operation or a once in a while check your dashboard or check your firewall once in a while. No, it has to be intentionally done 24 by 7. The takeaway, we also ensure that we offer cybersecurity awareness at no cost to you. We educate you on BEC, phishing, artificial intelligence, social engineering attacks, and the rest. We also do health checks regularly. I've seen this done by the team. Thank you for that. To ensure that you've configured your software solutions properly using best practices. For example, we've seen cases where customers will create a firewall rule to say from WAN to LAN traffic, any, which is quite risky. That means anyone, can come into your network. These are some of the things that we've pointed out to you during a health check. So some customers who may have bought Sophos Extreme Protection License that includes zero-day protection, but are not using any zero-day protection, policies, which is that's not good enough. So that means if someone tries to download a zero-day ransomware, or they get an email that has a zero-day ransomware attachment, there's no way the firewall will be able to detect that because you have not enabled that, policy to take place. The health check would help you to identify that and optimize your investment in software solution. That's basically what we're trying to do. So you're getting the maximum value from software. So if you need a health check, please reach out to the Casper team. Also, for Sophos customers, you're entitled to a complimentary home premium license. It's an antivirus for home use, a corporate antivirus, but for home use. So each license can protect up to 10 laptops per license, and each user gets one license. So if you have 1,000 users, each user will get one license. That license, when they take it home, they can protect up to 10 laptops for their home. So their kids, their spouse, their parents, their friends can be protected with just that single license. And this is a promise from Sophos. So thank you very much for joining us. I hope this has been informative. The recording will also be shared with you at the end of the discussion. So if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out. If you're not able to ask your questions here, you can reach out to the Casper team. If you want us to do a demonstration, if you want us to do a presentation for you, we are happy to take that up with you. Thank you very much. Over to you, Casper team.
Okay, thank you very much, Chris. That was very insightful, and I believe our participants really enjoyed the session. So, moving forward, we would like to make this very engaging. So, we would like to have some questions, and so far, we don't have any in the chat box. So, the floor is open for anyone that has the question. You can unmute and ask the question. Chris is here to take up your question. Thank you. I believe I'm audible, and it's quite surprising actually that for such an interesting topic and presentation that we are not getting the necessary feedback that we anticipated. But notwithstanding, we can still proceed, and because we'll have our post-webinar survey that will be shared tomorrow,
Hello.
so that's okay.
Hello, good morning.
Okay, good morning.
Okay. My name is Etienne Manuel from Radis Pension Managers. I'm sorry I came in a little bit late. So I'm hoping that I'll get the video after the presentation. But I picked one last comment by the presenter that's giving a free 10 licenses. I don't know if this new development, because we are using software as we speak. I want to know if, yeah, this license free stuff, is it a new development? So that I can tap into it. And I also heard you said you do some free health check. I wouldn't mind having that done on our premises, by Casper. Casper is my team, so I believe they are here to assist me on that. So maybe when I go through the presentation, able to have one or two questions to ask, because I came in a little bit late. So thank you.
Okay, Chris, I don't know if you have a question, answer to the question on the home premium.
Okay, so for the home premium, this is for all SoftWorks customers. So you would need to send an email to Casper to request for your home premium license. You will specify the number of users that you have. So every user within the organization that has an email ID will be able to claim that license. So your users would need to enter their email ID, and the voucher will be sent to them from that portal that will be sent to shared with you by Casper. So they will claim that using that their email ID. So every year, as you renew your
Okay.
SoftWorks licenses, that license also be renewed for you. It's not a free antivirus. It actually costs about $40. So for every user, they're
Okay.
getting a free $40 worth of antivirus. That's what it means. So every year, as you renew your SoftWorks solution, you get that
Okay.
complimentary voucher renewed as well automatically. So send an email to your sales account manager at Casper, and we'll process this for you.
Okay.
So on the health check, I'll
So,
let
will I be able to
Casper
get?
talk to that.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, Mr. Etim. Also, your request for health check is also noted. And I believe Chris has been able to answer your question on the licensing, home premium license.
Yes. Yes,
Okay.
please. Yes, thank you.
Okay. Please, I would like to entertain some other few questions.
How about the video, the recordings of this thing? Would you be
Yes,
able to
of course.
share it
Yes,
with us?
yes, yes. You are
Okay.
also getting it as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Okay, aside Mr. Tim, can we entertain one or two questions before we can wrap up for today?
So can I make a comment?
Of course, yes. The floor is open, sir.
Yeah, I am not too happy that I missed this presentation. I wish I came in earlier. I was very, very busy on something. So I don't know who do I direct my questions to in case it goes through presentation, and I wish to ask one or two questions. We've just come out of some breach, data breach, and Casper
Okay.
was also among the team that helped us to look at the challenge. And so I really like to go through. Ask one or two questions. Who should I direct the question to?
Okay,
Is
so
it
you can
Casper
direct
or
your
you?
question to technical@caspartechng.com so we can take up
Okay.
whatever question that you have from there.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank
That's not the
you.
same.
Thank you.
Okay. In the absence of no questions, we would like to wrap up today. So, Chris, thank you very much for coming through for this presentation, and we really appreciate your expertise and insights on this particular topic. So, like I said earlier, the post-webinar survey link will be shared to us so that we can reach out if we have any questions and plan to take out some of the MDR features that have been discussed with us here today. So until then, we'll be wrapping up for today, but we
Hello.
still expect you. Okay, hello.
Toshi, sorry, I just want to chip something in before you wrap up.
Okay.
Good morning. Okay, we're still in the morning. Good morning, everyone. So this webinar is the first of a series that we'll be having. And please, I would like us to join the next one that will be coming after this. So it's a series, and it's going to be like we'll be building on this one. For the next one, and I promise you, it's going to be impactful, and it's going to be useful for your organization. So please, we'll be sending you in the future registration link. Try to register, and if you have, people within the IT space in other companies, you can also share the link to them so they can also be part of it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Toyo, for that. So, thank you, everyone, for taking time out to join us on this webinar today. From me to you, from Casper to you, bye for now and stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.